الحمد لله وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم ما بعد. Continuing on in our treatise, which has to do with the Islamic creed, the creed in accordance with Ahl al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah, which was espoused by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and revealed by him, salawatu rabbi wa salamu alayhi, revealed to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in accordance with the understanding of the Sahaba and preserved by the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in and passed down to generation and generation by those who came after the Sahaba like the Tabi'een wa Tiba'a Tabi'een and those who follow them unto the Day of Judgment holding the same creed, same minhaj, same methodology of Ahl Sunnati wa Jama'ah. And so we reached the point in the treatises where the Shaykh said in chapter 21, he said the status of the Sunnah. So after discussing in the last lesson, we talked a little bit about belief in the messengers as a pillar of Islam or a pillar of Iman. And we talked a little bit about following the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We reached to the point of the status of the Sunnah of the Messenger of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Shaykh went on to say that the Sunnah is revelation just like the Quran is revelation. The Sunnah expounds the Quran, meaning it explains the Quran. The Sunnah makes clear what is implied or implicit in the Quran, for verily Allah the Almighty commands with prayer and paying the zakat and other acts of worship. And the Sunnah makes the details comprehensible and comprehensible. So we know how to pray, we know how to pay zakat, we know how to do all those acts of worship, and we know the pillars and arkan and wajibat of them because of the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why Islam and the Sunnah are one. There's no separation. You can't say, I'm a Muslim, I follow the Quran. How many people who are on batil, on falsehood, who say, I'm a Muslim, but I don't follow the Sunnah. I'm a Muslim, but I follow the Quran. This is not possible. It's impossible. It's absolutely impossible. It's like a Christian who says, I don't follow the Bible. I don't believe in the Bible. Or a person who says they're an Arab and they don't have any ties with the Arabic language or to Arab culture, nor in their bloodlines. So this is absolutely not possible. The Sunnah, as Imam Barbahari, a 3rd century scholar or 4th century scholar, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, As-sunnah hi al-islam wa islam hu as-sunnah. Imam Barbahari, rahimahullah ta'ala, one of the early scholars, was on the madhab of Imam Ahmed in his fiqh. He said, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that Islam is the sunnah and sunnah is Islam. So you cannot separate the two. Absolutely impossible. Islam, when you say Islam, that means you follow the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you accept Islam and if you follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said when he said, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa radaytu lakum Islam adina. When Allah said that he completed his religion upon it, then that means you're following the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa atiyu Allah wa atiyu Rasul wa awlal amr minkum, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that follow Allah and follow and be obedient to his messenger and those who are charged in authority over you, that means you're following Islam. And that means you're following the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You can't say you follow the Quran and leave off the Sunnah, unlike some of those people who've totally deviated from Islam, and some of them to the extent where they're no longer Muslim. If they reject the Sunnah, to reject the Sunnah means you've rejected Islam. Because there's no way, it's impossible to follow Islam without the Sunnah. The Sunnah is in the Quran, and so if you believe the Quran, then you will believe in the Sunnah and you'll follow the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The fourth thing the Shaykh mentioned regarding the status of the Sunnah, and there's so much ample adilla, you know, those are, you can make a lecture, and we have lectures, and there's many lectures out there from the Talabat al-Ilm, and from the Tulab al-Ilm, and from the Du'at, and from others, and the scholars. There's a plethora of evidence, and a plethora of lectures, in durus, and treatises, and rasail, and books, and fatawa talking about the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you can go back to for details regarding this issue. And going back to the books of Aqidah, the early books of creed of the Salaf al-Salih, Ridwanullah alayhim ajma'een, or jami'an, that you'll find in their books a plethora of discussions and evidence talking about the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the status of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the status of his sunnah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The sunnah specifies what is general in the Quran. Allah has already prohibited eating dead animal meat, for example, meaning meat that's not slaughtered, and blood. The sunnah makes exceptions, because that's how we know what's halal and haram. We know it from the Quran and the sunnah. For example, in the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ mentioned dead locusts and sea animals, and from blood, spleen, and liver. Those things are mentioned in the sunnah. They're not mentioned in the Quran. We know those details from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The sunnah expounds upon the Quran. So then Allah prohibited one from marrying the woman that suckled him, as she is considered to him a mother. So also the girl that has been suckled together with him by one woman, as she is considered his sister. So these are details which are prohibited from and expounded upon in the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The sunnah expounded by the virtue of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, whatever is made haram or prohibited because of blood relation is also made haram because of suckling. This is expanded upon and expounded upon in the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is how we know these ahkam, these rulings, whether it's halal and whether it's haram. The Shaykh went on to say and mention in the next chapter, chapter 22, he said the last day. This is also a pillar of Iman. The last day, it is the day of judgment. And the meaning of it is to believe in everything that is, that will take place. Everything that will take place. After death, from the punishment of the grave and the comfort of it. So we believe in Adab al-Qabr. This is part of Ahl Islam's creed. This is part of Ahl Sunnah's creed, where some groups like the Ibadiyya and some other sects, some sects of the Khawarij, some sects of the modern-day groups like Hizb al-Tahrir and others, reject the Adab al-Qabr. But this is clearly from the Quran. Clearly, we've text Nusus from the Quran that makes that points to it implicitly, and we have expounded details in the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as in the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, where he said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said was walking. He said, "Marra Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam ala qabrain, فقال إنهم ليعذبان وما يعذبان في كبير أما أهرهما فلا يستتر من البول ولما آخر فكان يمشي بالنميمة." So in this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking by some graves, and they were graves of the people who came before us, like the Jews and the Christians. I believe it was mentioned that they were Jews in some of the details of other regarding this narration. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking by their graves, and then he mentioned, he said, "Verily they are being punished, and they're not being punished by something which the people think, they're being punished by something the people take lightly." And then he said, "As for one of them, they used to not properly clean themselves when they went to the restroom, either because they allowed urine to splash on their clothing, or they didn't properly clean off their private part when making istinja, akramakum Allah." And he said, "Amma ahluhuma fakana la yastathiru min al-bawl, wa ma akhru fakana yamshi min namima." He said, "And as for the other one, is that they used to spread tales amongst the people with the intention to spread falsehood and enmity between the people." And so this is evidence for the punishment of the grave. It shows us from the sunnah that people will be and are punished and being punished in their graves, and that some people have comfort in their graves. That's just one of the evidences of the many, and there's detailed hadith, a very long hadith, which mention about the angels that are in there and the punishments and the things, the torments that people will experience due to what they did in this life and according to their belief. Did they have Iman Billah, or did they have Iman and faith in the shaitan? Did they follow the devil, or did they follow Allah? Did they follow their desires, or did they follow the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and restrain themselves and follow khair. So part of the iman in the last day, the belief in the last day, is believing in the punishment in the grave and the comfort of it. The resurrection after that, and the accounting of deeds and the weighing of deeds, and the reward and punishment of paradise and hellfire, and everything that Allah has characterized the day of judgment with, and is included, that the believers, and or included with that is also that the believers will see their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. Some of the people of knowledge mention the signs of the last day in this chapter when mentioning the last day, because the day of judgment is preceded by signs that prove it will happen soon. Therefore, belief in it has not only become compulsory, but is considered the very backbone of faith. And as we mentioned before, it's one of the pillars of iman. The Prophet ﷺ said, when Jibreel ﷺ asked him about iman, أخبرني عن iman, he said, tell me about iman. He said, تؤمن بالله والملائكة وكتبه ورسوله واليوم الآخر. Ah, واليوم الآخر, the day of judgment. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَتُؤْمِنَ بِقَدْرِ خَيْرِي وَشَرِ, and belief in divine destiny, the good and the evil of it. Those are pillars of iman, the six pillars of iman, and as we know, there are five pillars of Islam. The Shaykh went on to mention in the next chapter, chapter 23, he said, paradise and hellfire are both existent creations. They both exist. Paradise is the dwelling place for the obedient pious ones, and the hellfire is the dwelling place for the disbeliever and the oppressive sinner, and they, paradise and hellfire, will remain existent absolutely forever. They will not be destroyed. It is not permissible for anyone to claim that someone will go to paradise or to the hellfire except those who Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, declared to be in the hellfire or declared to be in paradise. That's incredibly important, as some people say, oh, so-and-so, this leader is in the hellfire, or this individual is in paradise. We don't have that knowledge. This is knowledge of the unseen. I cannot say about myself. I cannot say about my mother. I cannot say about anyone that they're going to be in the hellfire or they're going to be in paradise. But we can say that what we see from their deeds, it looks like they're going to the hellfire. But we don't know how they're going to die. Are they going to die by making the testimony of faith and having all their sins forgiven and believing in it and then dying on that? Are they going to die? Are they going to be a believer who was known for iman and known for scholarship and doing jihad fi sabilillah and all these beautiful righteous deeds, and then right before they died, they disbelieved in Allah, وَعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. And there's an authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ لِيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلَ أَهْلَ الْجَنَّةِ in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ لِيَعْمَلُ بِعَمَلَ أَهْلَ الْجَنَّةِ حَتَّى مَا يُكُون بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهُ ذِرَاعًا فَيُسْبِكُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ فَيَعْمَلَ بَعَمَلَ أَحْلَ النَّارِ فَيُدْخِلَهَا. So the Prophet ﷺ said that one of you will be very close to entering paradise, meaning they were doing righteous deeds, until what was written will overtake them, and they will do the deeds of the hellfire, and they will enter it. Meaning that they were an arm span length. They were very close to entering paradise. But then what was written will overtake them. This has to do with the decree, the divine decree, as we'll talk about very shortly. And they will enter the hellfire. وَعِيَاذَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. So we ask that Allah gives us a righteous ending, because none of us knows. So that's why it's imperative to know. We can't say, for example, many people, they have issues regarding Saddam Hussein and different people who some of the scholars, or many of the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah, declared were disbelievers during their life, because they believed in communist principles over Islam. They didn't, you know, and they well, those are the main reasons, is the back principles, and that's why people like great scholars like Bin Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala, and others, Sheikh Muqbil, Allah yarhamuhu, they made takfir of people like Saddam Hussein. And as we saw, that was broadcast all over the internet and all over the world, that Saddam Hussein, when his Shia Rafidi captured the people who held him in captivity, when they executed him, he said, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah." Huh. But we don't know how he met his Lord. We don't know what was in his heart. We rule by the Zahir. And some of the scholars say that that would be accepted from him. Some of the scholars said no, because he had to distance himself, unless he distanced himself, from his Hizb-Ba'ath principles. Those communist ideology where they worship the party. They worship the party in Arab nationalism over La ilaha illallah. They, La ilaha illallah meant nothing to them. But the communist Hizb-Ba'ath principles meant everything. Look at Bashar, this evil, wicked shaitan who's killing the Muslims of Ahl al-Sunnah. La'natullah alayh. May Allah curse him. And may Allah remove him from power and put Ahl al-Sunnah in place. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. So the point being here is that it is not permissible for anyone to claim that someone will go to the paradise or to the hellfire, except those who Allah has mentioned in the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the authentic Sunnah. And so that's why Ahl Sunnah we restrain from saying, although there are some differences with some of the scholars say that you can say this, but ultimately this amr is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one knows who's in the hellfire. We can't even say Adolf Hitler was in the hellfire unless we know for sure he died upon his disbelief. Okay? The evidence shows us from how he lived his life, his evil, and that he probably lived that all the way to his ending. But I wasn't in the room when he committed suicide. We don't know. So we leave off that matter. We leave that to Allah. His reckoning is with Allah. In the next chapter, chapter 24, the Shaykh went on to say, belief in predestination and the divine decree. So this is Al-Qadr. This is the last pillar of Iman. Belief in predestination and the divine decree, it is Allah's decreeing of all things in existence and His knowledge of them before they came into being. And belief in predestination has four levels. Arba maratib. The first one is knowledge. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge of everything completely with minute details. And His knowledge of things before they came into existence, and from His knowledge is the actions of the believers or actions of worshippers before they do them. The glorified Subhana knows what was and what will be and what didn't happen, and if it were to happen, how it would be. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His knowledge is all encompassing. Our knowledge is infinite, is restricted, is restrained, is imperfect, is mahdood. We're so restricted, but Allah sees and hears and knows everything. The second level of the Qadr is the writing, is Al-Kitaba. It is that Allah the Almighty wrote everything in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz, the preserved tablet. It's all written. Everything that will happen, everything that has happened, is written in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz. And the third thing is the will, or Al-Mashiyah. And what is meant by this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's comprehensive will for everything that occurs and His complete power and control over it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything happens within accordance with His will. And this also is divided into two types. We say Mashiyah Qawniyah wa Mashiyah Shar'iyah. Mashiyah Qawniyah has to do with that nothing escapes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will. Okay? That nothing escapes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will. Allah created everything and He decreed everything. Subhanah. The other type of Mashiyah is the Mashiyah Shar'iyah. And this has to do with the legislated will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning those things which are pleasing to Allah. So Allah decreed everything. He allows for people to have the choice to believe and not to believe, to strive to go to paradise or to go to the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us and given us that limited free will to do those deeds in order and follow guidance. However, what is pleasing, the type of will, the shari'iyah, those things which are pleasing to Allah, this aspect of will is those things which are pleasing and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. For example, Allah gave us Islam and loves Islam and loves the believers and loves those people who are purified and loves those people of Iman who have faith. Allah loves that. However, He allows people to even disbelieve. There are people, of course, a huge part of the world disbelieves in Allah and they disbelieve in the Sharia. They disbelieve in Islam and Islamic commandments. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them the free will to do so. However, they will be held accountable for that. they will be punished for that if they don't accept Islam and die upon Islam. And so, this has to do with the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's his Mashiach or his will, which is regarding the Sharia will, meaning those things that he loves, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He loves that the believers make salat. Okay? He loves that we pay zakat. He loves that we do good deeds, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth category, or maratib, or level of the qadr, is the creation, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything. That Allah is the creator for everything, and He founded it all, and that He is the only creator, and there is nothing that was created except by Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The categories, the Shaykh went on to mention the categories of decrees. He said, the categories of decrees, he said, the complete decree, that everything that exists was written in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz, the preserved tablet. And then number two is the age decree. It is that the affairs of the fetus were written while it was in the stomach of its mother, such as its wealth, its work, and its lifespan, and its sadness, and its happiness. And this is authenticated in authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we mentioned part of that hadith when we mentioned about the decree of whether how someone will die. And the third category of the of decree is the yearly decree, and it is what is decreed during the night of power, Laylatul Qadr. Like what Allah the Almighty said, فِيمَا يُفَرَقْ كُلُّ أَمْرٍ حَكِيمٍ. It is, in it, it distinguishes every wise affair. And the daily decree, as Allah the Almighty said, every day He is engaged in some affair. كُلُّ يَوْمٌ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. كُلُّ يَوْمٌ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. Every day He is engaged in some affair. And it is what He decreed from daily occurrences such as life and death and giving honor or disgrace. All of these are a part of the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Continuing what was introduced before in the chapter on divine decree, it is compulsory upon the Muslim that he knows the following. So regarding al-qadr and decree, we have to know and we have to believe in the following. That what afflicts him or her would not miss him, and that what that which missed him was not meant to afflict him. So everything happens for a reason. And what you miss, what missed happening to you, the choice that you didn't make, or the thing that didn't happen that you wanted to happen, or the result that you wanted to happen by your striving that didn't happen, it was not meant to happen for you. The second thing is, it's not permissible to use the divine decree as an excuse to do a sinful act or leaving obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands. You can't say, oh, it's the qadr of Allah. I committed adultery, it's the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's Allah's decree. I was forced to do it. No, this is the aqidah of the Jabriyah, those people who believe that they are forced to do actions. But no, that's not what divine will of Allah and divine decree means. So it's not permissible to use the decree as an excuse to commit sins, or use the decree as an excuse to leave off doing righteous deeds. And the third thing that we need to be aware of with regards to divine decree, it is not permissible to engage in deep conversation and contemplation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree in the divine destiny, because it is from the knowledge of the unseen. So it's knowledge that we have limited knowledge about. We believe in it in as far as we know from the authentic sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and how they understood it. That's sufficient for us. And what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost described for us and told us in the Quran. So this is from ilm al-ghayb. We can't go deeply into it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said regarding this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if the qadr, the divine destiny, is mentioned, then keep silent. This is what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as was narrated by Tabarani from Ibn Mas'ud, that if the qadr is mentioned, then keep silent. Don't go deep into the qadr. He said, then to delve into divine decree results in, and there's some results when we go into divine decree, when we go in beyond our head. Number one, firstly, one of the things that can happen is that we can fall into denial, negating the qadr. The second thing is that we can end up protesting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree, trying to go against the decree, saying, oh, you know, why did Allah do this to me? Why did Allah allow this to happen to me? A'udhu billah min dhalika. So this is a very dangerous, serious thing. It could lead to kufr, leaving the fold of Islam. So intabih, be careful. And the third thing is that it can lead to confusion and nullification of sound creed. Is that it can lead to nullifying our faith, and it can lead to confusion. But instead, just understand to the degree that we've already discussed, this is sufficient for you with regarding the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not to go deep into it. Instead, strive to do righteous deeds, and strive to get the good results, and leave it at that, and tawakkal on Allah, depend upon Allah. But don't try to get into philosophy and philosophizing about the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine destiny, because this is how many of the original sects in Islam, how they went astray. Some of them went astray with regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine names and attributes, and some of them they went astray, like the Qadariya, with regarding the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where they denied the Qadr altogether. Or some said that they were forced to do deeds, so that you should quit doing actions. All of this is falsehood. All of this leads to going astray, and this leads to kufr, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, Al-ma'asi barid al-kufr. So this sinfulness is a means to kufr. And also shubahat, you know, doubtfulness, getting into doubtful matters. This can lead you to disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to question your Lord subhanahu. So intabi, be away from it. The next chapter, the Shaykh went on to mention, he began to mention about ihsan, and this is also mentioned in the hadith of Jibreel that we mentioned, where the Prophet ﷺ was asked by the angel Jibreel about ihsan, and he said, and it is to worship Allah as if you see Him. So since you cannot see Him, meaning you cannot see Allah, then know that He sees you, and this has two levels. Firstly, the level of the witness. Like he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, said, al-ihsan is to worship Allah as if you see Him. So you should worship Allah and do things as if you see Allah. So if you were to be aware, being conscious, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching, you would not do the sins that you're doing. And you would have full focus and concentration and khushur and khashia and khudur in your salat. You would be focused and you would be fearing Allah while you're praying and worshiping Him. Because you would know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching you and is in front of you. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, instead, we cannot see Him, and we know that He subhanahu wa ta'ala sees us. So we have to be aware of that. The second level of ihsan, it is the aspect of being observed. Like what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so since you cannot see Him, meaning you cannot see Allah, then know that He sees you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees you. He's aware of all your deeds. And may Allah forgive us because we're aware of this, but we if we were truly aware, we would not do the sins that we do during the day and during the evening. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and grant us success in this life as well as the hereafter. Anything I said that was correct was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything I said that was incorrect was from myself and the shaitan. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad.